Hello students, welcome to back our physics class. Let's go to limitation of Bohr's theory. In previous class, we discussed Bohr's atomic model, in which we go through Bohr's postulates, radius of different orbit, velocity of an electron in different orbit, energy of different orbit, and wavelength of electromagnetic radiation. Also, here we study that if an electron may transition from lower energy level to higher energy level, it absorbs energy, and with emission of energy, it can go back from higher energy level to lower energy level. One of the best advantages of Bohr's theory that is he explained about the stability of an atom, which is the drawback of Rutherford's atomic model. In case of Rutherford's atomic model, stability of an atom, that is the drawback. Here, in case of Bohr's theory, he explained about stability of an atom. Also, in the Bohr's atomic theory, they have some limitation. Now, we go through it. What happened? That first limitation, it is only applicable for hydrogen-like atom and fails to explain in case of atoms with two or more electrons. That means, in case of Bohr's theory, what happened? They only explain about hydrogen-like single electron atom. That means, in case of hydrogen, electron number is 1. Like, if we go through that helium, that electron number, that is 2, because helium, that atomic number is 2. So, atomic number 2, that means number of electron and number of proton is also 2. But Bohr's theory is only applicable for helium plus. In this case, electron number is 1. Bohr's theory is valid for this, but does not explain about the number of electrons. In case of lithium, lithium plus plus or lithium 2 plus. In this concept, Bohr's theory is applicable, but not for the number of electrons. If an atom have 2 or more electrons, like lithium, 3 electrons. In this case, there is no explanation in case of Bohr's theory. And the second limitation, it does not explain why only we consider about the circular orbit, whereas elliptical orbits are possible or not. If we consider an atom, we consider about the orbit are in circular manner. As elliptical orbits is possible, elliptical orbits are possible or not, that is not explained by Bohr's theory. Then next one, he unable to explain the debugly concept of dual nature of matter. That means, a matter exists both particle nature and wave nature. Here, electron is also exhibit particle nature, but does not explain the wave characteristic. In case of Bohr's theory, he does not explain about the wave nature. Wave nature of electron. If electron is in wave nature, then is the circular orbit is exactly defined by Bohr's theory? Okay, if we consider this one is nucleus, okay, and electron is in wave-like form, wave-like structure, then as that circular orbit is exactly defined, that is not explained by Bohr's theory, which is we later discuss in our next lecture, De Broglie hypothesis. Okay, then the next limitation, it could not explain the fine structure and relative intensity of spectral lines. If we go through the transition of electron from higher energy level to lower energy level, if we consider this one is one spectral line. If this orbit is take as n equals to 3 and this orbit take as n equals to 2, that is the Balmer series. Okay, so this single spectral line is consisting of number of spectra, okay, number of lines. The fine feature or fine lines are not fine lines that is not explained by Bohr's theory. Also, if we go through the total spectral series like Lehmann series or Balmer series, in case of Balmer series, one of the example, okay, if electron may transition from 3 to 2 or 4 to 2 or 5 to 2, okay, that an orbit 5 to 2 or 4 to 2, then what is the intensity of this spectral lines? Which line is more intense and which line is less intense is not explained by Bohr's theory. Relative intensity of this spectral line is not explained. And another limitation, it does not explain the further splitting of spectral line in a magnetic field or an electric field. If we consider a single spectral line, if we consider a single spectral line in the presence of electric field or in the presence of magnetic field, that single spectral line is also further split. Okay, the single spectral line is also further split. In case of magnetic field, in the presence of magnetic field, if a single spectral line is further split, that effect is called as Zeeman effect. That effect is called as Zeeman effect. Then, if we consider a single spectral line and that is further split in the presence of electric field, that effect is called as Stokes effect. Okay, Stokes effect in the presence of electric field and Zeeman effect in the presence of magnetic field. Here what happened? That single spectral line in the presence of magnetic field and electric field further split. And why it is further split? That this was not explained by Bohr's theory. And the last one, they could not explain the uncertainty principle. That means, in case of Heisenberg uncertainty principle, they suggest that an electron in a particular time, we could not define, if we consider this one as nucleus and this one as electron, for a particular time, we could not define or could not derive, okay, could not define or could not derive the exact position as well as exact momentum of the electron. Okay, exact position as well as exact momentum. That means electron have a particular position and it have velocity theta g and electron have mass m. Okay, so at a particular time we could not exactly define the position as well as the momentum of the electron. These are the drawbacks of Bohr's theory. Students, here we discuss some numericals of atomic structure. So the first question, what is the energy of a photon that when absorbed by an electron in lithium 2 plus to be excited from n equals to 1 to n equals to 3? That means if we consider a lithium atom, okay, if we consider a lithium atom, this one is the nucleus and this one equals to n equals to 1 orbit. This one is the n equals to 1 orbit, this one equals to n equals to 2 and this orbit is n equals to 3. As in case of n equals to 1, energy level that is E1, and for n equals to 2, the second orbit, energy level that is E2, and for the third level, n equals to 3, energy level that is E3. Here the question is, if electron absorbs energy, it can go from the lower energy level n equals to 1 to n equals to 3, then what is the amount of energy that electron absorbs? So what is the amount of energy that absorbs? E equals to E3 minus E1. You individually calculate the value of E3 or calculate the value of E1. Also, we put another formula also. We know that En equals to minus 13.6 electron volt into Z square divided by N square. So for E3, that is minus 13.6 Eb Z square divided by 3 square minus 13.6 Z square electron volt Z square divided by 1 square. Okay, in between these two, 13.6 electron volt and Z square, that is the common value calculate then for the 13.6 electron volt into Z square by 1 by 3 square minus 1 by 1 square. Minus common, okay? Then what happened? For lithium atom, Z equals to 3. Put the value minus 13.6 electron volt into 3 square. Then here solve this one, 1 by 9 minus 1 by 1. Then calculate this one, what is the answer? That answer equals to 1 minus 9 by 9. This one equals to 1 minus 9 divided by 9. Then minus 13.6 electron volt into 3 square, that is 9, into that is minus 8 by 9. Okay, then minus minus plus 9 cancel, 13.6 electron volt into 8. Then that answer equals to 108.8 electron volt. Okay, you got it? That means 108.8 electron volt. If electron absorb, then that electron jump from n equals to 1 to n equals to 3. Then we go to the next question. The energy of an electron in the hydrogen atom is known to be expressible in the form of En equals to minus 13.6 electron volt by n square. Using the expression so that electron of hydrogen atom cannot have energy of minus 6.8 electron volt. For the hydrogen atom Z equals to 1. As we go to that energy in the first orbit energy is taken as E1, that is equals to minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 1 square. Then that answer equals to minus 13.6 electron volt. Then for the energy in the second orbit, E2 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 2 square. Then the answer is, that is minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 4, 2 square 4. Then answer is minus 3.4 electron volt. Then further, in case of third orbit, the energy level E3 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 3 square, that is equals to 9, and that answer is minus 1.51 electron volt. Then go to that next fourth orbit, that energy level E4 equals to minus 7.6 electron volt divided by 4 square, that means minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 16. Then this one equals to minus, okay, that is 0.85 electron volt. So we here conclude that for every orbit we can determine the energy level from 1 to 4. We can determine the energy level and it gradually decreases. In that orbit 4, okay, that energy equals to minus 0.85 electron volt. In between E1 to E4, there is no value of minus 6.8 electron volt. Okay, as we know that in the case of Bohr's postulate, every atom possesses a particular energy level. So here we does not got any amount that energy level that is equal to minus 6.8 electron volt. So here we conclude that energy level is not in between 1 to 4 or in further, it does not get the energy that is minus 6.8 electron volt, because at E infinity that is equal to 0 electron volt. Okay? Then next one we go to next problem. So next we go to another question. Here the question is, using Rydberg constant, calculate the longest and shortest wavelength for Lehmann and Balmer series. So first one, students, in case of Lehmann series, as energy transistor is maximum, in that case wavelength is equals to xc by lambda, which is we discussed in our previous lecture. This one is take as n equals to 2. This orbit is take as n equals to 1, and this orbit is take as n equals to infinity. Okay, so as electron may transition from 2 to 1, in that case energy is minimum. So wavelength, in this case the radiation, emitted radiation have maximum wavelength, whereas when electron make transition from infinity to 1, okay, from infinity to 1, in that case energy radiated, that is maximum. So here that emitted radiation having wavelength, that is minimum. Or here we got the longer wavelength, whereas here we got shorter wavelength. Now in same for Balmer series, if electron make transition from n equals to 3 to n equals to 2, here this one electron emit radiation, that energy is minimum. So here the emitted radiation having maximum wavelength or got longer wavelength, whereas when electron make transition from n equals to infinity, from n equals to infinity to n equals to 2, n equals to infinity to n equals to 2, in that case energy radiation, that is maximum. So here we got emitted radiation having minimum wavelength, or shorter wavelength of radiation we got. So in this case, this one n1 equals to 1 and n2 equals to 2. For shorter wavelength n1 equals to 1 and n2 equals to infinity, and in this case n1 equals to 2, n2 equals to 3, whereas in case of longer wavelength n1 equals to 2 and n2 equals to infinity. You put the value of n1 and n2 in the common formula, that 1 by lambda equals to r into 1 by n1 square minus 1 by n2 square, and put the value so that you can calculate longer wavelength, shorter wavelength for Lyman series as well as in case of Balmer series. Now go to another question. The question is, the ground state of energy of hydrogen atom is minus 13.6 electron volt. That means in the ground state that energy is minus 13.6 electron volt, we know that. What is the kinetic energy of the second excited state? And what is the potential energy of the fourth excited state? Here question is potential energy. If electron jumps from ground state from the third excited state, calculate the wavelength. Then students, what happened here? We calculate the kinetic energy of the second excited state. This one is the first excited state and this one is the second excited state. As in ground state, that n equals to 1, first excited state n equals to 2, and second excited state n equals to 3, and the third excited state and the fourth excited state. Okay, so here the third excited state n equals to 4 and the fourth excited state n equals to 5. Yes, then E1 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt. Here I am just give you the hints, then you follow this one, follow the hints and try to solve the questions. So if the kinetic energy of the second excited state, that n equals to 3, so E3 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 3 square. Students, your energy we calculate for the hydrogen atom. For hydrogen atom z equals to 1. Okay, E3 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt by 3 square, that is 9. So that answer equals to minus 1.51 electron volt. Yes, then What is the potential energy of the fourth excited state? First one, we calculate the kinetic energy. Okay, so for the fourth excited state, n equals to 5. So n equals to 5, we calculate that E5 equals to, here this one is the kinetic energy, minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 5 square. Okay, that is minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 25. Then that answer is, you calculate the answer which is already I give you that answer. Okay, next, what is the formula for the potential energy? First one, here in case of kinetic energy, that formula is half mv square. Okay, and for potential energy, that is minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 z d square by r. Then this one equals to minus k z e square by r. Okay, k z e square by r. Here half mv square, where mv square, that is mv square by r equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 z d square by r square. R cancel. Then here half mv square equals to k z e square by r. Okay, put the value of mv square, this one, half k z e square by r. So what is the relation between potential energy and kinetic energy? That kinetic energy equals to half k z e square by r, and here that k z e square by r, that is the value of potential energy. Okay, so kinetic energy is equals to half of potential energy. Here we calculate kinetic energy, then what is the potential energy of fourth excited state? Potential energy of fourth excited state, okay, potential energy of fourth excited state, that is equals to 2 into kinetic energy, 2 into kinetic energy of fourth excited state. So put the value, calculate this value and put in here 2 into this value. Then you can solve the potential energy of the fourth excited state. Okay, then here another question. If electron jump from ground state from the third excited state. Okay, here for third excited state, n equals to 4. As n equals to 4, E4 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 4 square. You can calculate the energy of E4. Okay, then here the question, electron jumps from third excited state to the ground state. That means electron jump from third excited state to ground state. That means E equals to E4 minus E1. Okay, here we calculate E4. Put this value minus of E1, that is minus 13.6 electron volt, and calculate that. You can calculate your energy. Then we know that E equals to hc by lambda. Now lambda equals to hc by E. Okay, put the value of hc and E here. Asa, here you change the electron volt into joule. Okay, that one electron volt is equals to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. You put the value here. Change that electron volt into joule and put the value in this formula. Okay, now go to another problem. So that the shortest wavelength lines in Lehmann series, Volmer series and Pasten series have their wavelength in the ratio 1:4:9. First one, students, in case of shortest wavelength, you remember like this, shortest wavelength lambda minimum, that means in this case the energy radiation, that should be maximum. So in which case energy radiation that is maximum when electron make transition from infinity to the lower excited state. Okay, from infinity to the lower excited state. So what happened here? In case of Lehmann series, electron make transition from infinity to 1. In case of Bergmann series, electron make transition from infinity to 2. In case of Poisson series, electron make transition from infinity to 3. Then you calculate the value of lambda. Okay, so here 1 by lambda equals to R into 1 by 1 square minus 1 by infinity square. So this one infinity, 1 by infinity that is 0, then lambda equals to 1 by R. And in case of Bergmann series, 1 by lambda equals to R into 1 by 2 square minus 1 by infinity square. And this here 1 by infinity that is 0, then 1 by lambda equals to R by 4, lambda equals to 4 by R. Or lambda equals to 4 into 1 by R. In case of Poisson series, 1 by lambda equals to R into 1 by 3 square minus 1 by infinity square, and that is equals to 0. So this one equals to 1 by lambda equals to R by 9, lambda equals to 9 into 1 by 4, 1 by R. Then here lambda equals to 1 by R, in this case lambda equals to 4 into 1 by R, in this case lambda equals to 9 into 1 by R. So what is the ratio? That is equals to 1 by R is to 4 into 1 by R is to 9 into 1 by R, that means 1 is to 4 is to 9. Okay? Now go to another problem. That here question is, calculate the energy of the hydrogen atom. Calculate the energy of the hydrogen atom in the state n equals to 4 and n equals to 2. Determine the frequency and wavelength of the emitted radiation in a transition from n equals to 4 to n equals to 2. That means here three questions is given. One is we determine at n equals to 4 and n equals to 2 what is the energy level of hydrogen atom, and if an electron make transition from n equals to 4 to n equals to 2, then what is the frequency and wavelength of the emitted radiation. Then first one, here we go to that each as we take that orbit n equals to 4, then what is the energy level? That E4 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt by n square. And here we determine for hydrogen atom, so Z equals to 1. Okay, then what is E4? You calculate. Then for n equals to 2, E2 equals to minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 2 square. Here for n equals to E4, that is minus 13.6 electron by 4 square, and here minus 13.6 electron volt divided by 2 square. You calculate this one, that is that answer equals to minus 0.85 electron volt, and here this one equals to minus 3.4 electron volt, which is we calculate in our previous lecture. Now as electron make transition from 4 to 2, as electron make transition from 4 to 2, then what is the amount of energy it radiate? That E equals to E4 minus E2. Put that value, E4 that is minus 0.85 minus of minus 3.4 electron volt, and this one equals to, you solve this one, minus 0.85 plus 3.4 electron volt, then that answer is 2.55 electron volt. Okay, 2.55 electron volt. You first convert that electron volt into joule form. Okay, that means 2.55 into, one electron volt. One electron volt equals to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay, so here 2.55 electron volt equals to 2.55 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay, then we know that E equals to h nu. E equals to h nu. So nu is the frequency of the emitted radiation. Here in question, determine the frequency and wavelength of the emitted radiation. So you determine the frequency. So nu equals to E by h. Okay. So nu equals to E by h. So here E, put the value E, that is 2.55 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 divided by h. H is the Planck's constant, that is 6.63 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. Then you calculate frequency. Okay. Here this one equals to multiplying this one, that is 4.08 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule divided by h, that is 6.63 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. You cancel joule, joule cancel, then you calculate it. Then nu equals to, calculate this one, nu equals to that is 6.16 into 10 to the power 14 hertz, 1 by second, second inverse, or you return, take that unit hertz. Now we know that nu equals to c by lambda. Nu equals to c by lambda. That lambda is the wavelength. Okay, so what is lambda? Lambda equals to c by nu. Okay, lambda equals to c by nu. We know that c, that is velocity of light, that is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second divided by nu. Put this value 6.16 into 10 to the power 14 second inverse. Then you solve this one. Second, second inverse, you cancel. Okay, then that answer is in the form of meter. And you solve this one, that is equals to 4.87 into 10 to the power minus 7 meter. Okay, here the question is the wavelength of h alpha line in Balmer series is 6563 angstrom. Compute the wavelength of h beta line of Balmer series. First one, in case of Balmer series, that ground state n equals to 2 and the excited state, that is n equals to 3 or n equals to 4. Like here the h alpha line, that means electron make transition from 3 to 2, that line is take as h alpha. Remember this one, students, if electron make transition from the upper excited state to the lower excited state, just upper excited state to the lower excited state, that is represented by in form of h alpha. And as electron make transition from n equals to 4 to n equals to 2, then that line is represented by h beta. Then further, if electron make transition from n equals to 5 to n equals to 2, that is represented by h gamma. Okay, then so in h alpha, electron make transition from h alpha, electron make transition from n2 equals to 3 and n1 equals to 2, the 3 to 2. Okay, so what is the wavelength? 1 by lambda 3 2 equals to r 1 by n1 square minus 1 by n2 square. Put the value, then r into 1 by n1 square, that is 2 square, minus 1 by 3 square, that is 9. Okay, then solve it. Then 1 by lambda 3 2 equals to that answer 9 4 is 36, 9 minus 4 5 r by 36. Then here lambda 3 2 equals to 36 by 5 r, where the wavelength, that is 6563 angstrom. That means this one equals to 6563 angstrom, that is given in your question. Then what is alpha, h beta? So what is h beta? That h beta equals to the electron make transition from 4 to 2, that is wavelength 1 by lambda 4 2 equals to r 1 by n1 square minus
1 by n2 square, that is equals to r 1 by n1 square, that means 1 by 4 minus 1 by n2 square, that is 4 square, 1 by 16. Then solve this one, 1 by lambda 4 2 is equals to, solve this one, that is LCM is goes to 16, then 4 minus 1, that is 3 r by 16. Then answer is lambda 4 2 equals to 16 by 3 r.
Then here if we take the ratio between these two, here
lambda 4 2 this one and lambda 3 2 this one, if we take the ratio between these two, that lambda 4 2 by lambda 3 2, that is lambda 4 2 will put the value 16 by 3 r divided by lambda 3 2, that is 36 by 5 r. Okay, r r cancel. Here 16 by 3 into 5 by 36. Okay, then here lambda 4 2, we calculate lambda 4 2, this much is equals to this one multiply with lambda 3 2. Okay, then here you solve this one also. Okay, then here answer is this value, put this value into lambda 3 2. So put this value, okay, this answer is 20 by 27. Then put this value here, 20 by 27 divided by lambda 3 2. Okay, then lambda 3 2 put this value and calculate that lambda 4 2, that is equals to 20 by 27 into 6563, and calculate lambda 4 2. Okay,
next go to another question. Here the question is the time period of revolution of the electron in the third orbit in a hydrogen atom. Here we consider that hydrogen atom first orbit, second orbit, then third orbit. In the third orbit, the time period, the period means time period, okay, T3 is equal to, that is 4.22 into 10 to the power minus 15 second. At that electron position is third orbit. Hence find out the time period in the fifth orbit. So this one is the fourth and this one is the fifth orbit. In this case, what is the time period? You calculate. The first one, if electron is in third orbit, then what is the path it covered? The path is 2 pi r cube. Okay, first one, at the third orbit, what is the velocity? That is v3. Okay, what is the velocity? V3. And time period is taken as T3. Okay, so what is the time period? T3 equals to the total path covered by the electron divided by its velocity. We know that velocity equals to displacement divided by time. Okay, so what is time? Time equals to displacement divided by velocity. For general formula, we put that first one, we calculate for the general formula. If electron is revolving in nth orbit, then what is the total path? That is 2 pi rn. And what is its velocity? That is taken as vn. And what is the time period? Taken as tn. So what is tn? Tn equals to 2 pi rn by vn. Okay, here we put the value of rn and vn from the previous equation which we derive in our previous lecture, then we calculate tn. Okay, so what is tn? That is tn equals to 2 pi rn equals to n square h square divided by 4 pi square m k z e square into vn, that is 2 pi k z e square divided by n h. So solve this one, and 2 pi n h multiplying with
width above, then that answer is NQHQ divided by 4 pi square M, then K square, your Z square M E fourth.
Okay, 4 pi square, K square, Z square, M E fourth.
Here, 4 pi K Z M E all are the constant and H is the Planck's constant. So this all value are constant. Okay, then Tn is proportional to Nq. So here in general formula, we got that Tn is proportional to Nq, where N is the number of orbit. Okay, then how we find out the time period for fifth orbit? That if we take the proportion between T3 and T5, the T3 is proportional to 3q and T5 is proportional to 5q, because Tn is proportional to nq. So T3 is proportional to 3q, T5 is proportional to 5q. You put the value. Okay, then your T3 is proportional to 3q, so that T3 by T5 equals to 3q by 5q. Okay, then what is T5? T5 equals to 5q divided by 3q into T3. 5q divided by 3q into T3. 5q put the value and 3q you put the value, multiplying the time period T3. Okay, then you solve the answer, that 5q, that is 125, 3q 27 into T3, that is 4.22 into 10 to the power minus 15. Then you calculate T5. Okay, solve this one, you got T5.